Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest today, Diana Gould, has written a terrific novel called Cold Water. It's published by Rare Bird Books, and welcome, Diana.
Thank you very much.
And it begins at 2 a.m. when a woman named Brett can't finish writing a screenplay. She's living with her lover, who's the producer, and with his daughter, who has gone to bed, Julia. Mm-hmm. And she needs a kick. She needs to be a hit. And she goes. She gets it. And in her head, as she's driving and racing back to write it, she is on one of those curvy areas of Coldwater Canyon. And before she knows it, she has hit a woman on the side who has been changing a tire. Well, she doesn't stop, and that's really where it starts.
Wow. Yeah, that is the start of the book, and I think some people have a problem with that. I think this book took a long time to reach an audience, shall we say, and I think the reluctance to have a character, when people ask me about the book, I always hesitate to say exactly what happens in that first chapter.
Well, she's hit and she goes home.
Yeah.
And she does finish the script, but she knows she hasn't reported it, and if she is, she will be in trouble because she had a couple of drugs in her car and she had been drinking.
Mm-hmm.
But she calls the hospital, Cedars-Sinai, and they tell her she's in serious, but she's still alive.
Mm.
And on the third day, the poor woman has, I guess, what do they tell you? She has, there's another word, but she died.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And now she has to say, what do I do? Do I live with guilt or do I tell?
Mm-hmm.
And in living with it, she changes her personality.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what was it based on?
Well, you know, this book is a murder mystery, it's a thriller, it's a suspense novel, but
it's also a sociological study of daughters of rich men in the film industry.
Yes, well, thank you for that. But also, what I was going to say is that it didn't start out as a murder mystery or a thriller. That wasn't my intention. I hadn't really read a lot of them, and I don't know the genre. I wanted to tell a story about somebody who hates themselves, who makes the journey of transformation towards some kind of self-acceptance. And that was the impetus for the book, more than a nifty thriller, although it did turn out to be that. So what was it based on? Wasn't based on me, I can tell you that.
Good.
It never happened to me, thank God.
But the two girls, one is Kaylee, and the other is her sort of like the daughter of her lover.
Right, right.
And that's what her name is, Julia.
Julia, yes.
And Julia has said to her something about the girls at this very expensive prep school have been going out and being fixed up with foreign men in the city, and they can make $1,000 a night.
Well, not foreign men, but wealthy men.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And again, I have to say, that sounds like it could be real.
The phrase they use, I don't even know how to pronounce it, is Enjo Kosai, a Japanese phrase, and I meant to ask Naomi Hirahara, whom I did a blog talk radio with the other day, I meant to ask her about that because I had read about it. It's a fad in Japan. In fact, there's a movie, Japanese movie about it, of older men paying younger girls to go, theoretically just to go out with them, have dinner with them, talk to them, but also to have sex. So.
Yeah, and it's run by a madam. I mean, not unlike what we have read before in the hills. And fine, come, you don't have to do anything, but if you do and they are thrilled, you'll get paid.
Right. Well, and it, I don't know what to say about this.
Is it, well, I read it.
Yeah.
And you wrote it.
Yeah.
And I think it must be, and it does hold you. And the fact that the other girl, her best friend, Callie, well, her father is a man who pulls all the strings in the studios.
Right, right. Yes, I think the line I said about him is that there was one year where he got as a bonus more than the Writers Guild was asking for the entire membership for 3 years.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's very
and
healthy.
He has a wife whose whole pleasure is shopping. I mean, there's a little bit here that could be an Aaron and Candy spelling at one point. The house could be. It could be a couple of other people in the film industry. But they are there, and they can pull the strings.
Well, I did work in the film business for many years. I was fortunate enough to be a writer who went from one thing to another. And, you know, I kept my eyes open. And this wasn't a book that I could. You can do things in a book that you can't do in a movie. I think I wanted to write about television, but in a way that I could never have done on television.
Yeah. Well, our friend Brett comes up. She goes from the level she's at down to the point where Jonathan can't stand it anymore.
Right, right.
And he is a very proper, he is a suit, as they
yes,
call it.
Right, right.
But they break up. She goes through a little bit of getting some help. And she has a friend, Jerry, who's going to be working up in Canada. And he's got a house in Malibu on the ocean. Keep my house warm.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Well, she's in an ironic situation where she's at the absolute bottom. She's $180,000 in debt. She's homeless. She's jobless. She's drunk herself out of a career. She's unemployable. And yet she's living in this fabulous home in Malibu with a gorgeous view and, you know, state-of-the-art entertainment system.
And suddenly, not only is Callie missing, but so is Julia.
Yes.
And suddenly something does it to Brett in her soul, I guess, because she has been through mm-hmm. the mill.
Mm-hmm.
She has to get that child back.
That's right. Well, it starts with a sense of responsibility, but more than that, it's love that she, Brett is somebody who had a very difficult relationship with her own mother, was very wary of the mother-daughter relationship, but was thrust into this extended family. She and Jonathan never married, but she was raising his daughter as his mother, and there was a bond that formed between them that was very meaningful, and in fact, it is that love that she feels for Julia that's really the motivating energy of the book, and which finds her, you know, looking for Julia and forces her to take care of herself in a way that she hadn't when it was only about herself.
Now she... you do write a fantastic scene where Marty and his wife have to have a funeral because Callie has been found.
Mm.
And it is such a Hollywood scene between the burial and then the party afterwards where people are doing business out of one mouth while they're also in the other saying how sorry they were.
Well, you know, a friend of mine read this book, and she said, oh, the satire in that scene was just priceless. And I said, satire? I didn't write it as a satire.
Yeah.
I have a good ear, and I was just writing, you know, what
you see.
What you see and what you hear.
Yeah.
And it was an A-list funeral with, you know, everybody was there.
Uh-huh.
And it was a room that could be worked like no other.
And that's their chance. And even to the point that Brett herself, because she is not A-list anymore,
right.
wasn't invited, but she arranges to get herself invited.
Right.
Now, at the time, Julia is still missing.
Right.
Where is she? And Brett becomes friendly with a former, I guess, policeman named Mike.
Yes, yes, he was the tech advisor. She was the showrunner of a detective show, and he was a private eye, and he was their technical advisor.
Yeah. And he convinces her, go AA,
right,
because I have done it.
Right. Well, that was another one of the impetuses for me to write the book. I have a lot of alcoholism in my family and friends, and I've experienced, I see the toll that the disease takes, and I've seen what recovery can be. And I wanted to write a book where, you know, so often the end of the story is when someone admits that they're an alcoholic, but it seems to me that that is the beginning of the story. And I wanted to write a situation where there's a person who's newly sober, who always drank or used drugs to overcome fear or to get herself through barriers and to deal with life, who's then thrust in situation after situation, which is emotionally terrifying, physically threatening, dangerous, and she has to go through all of it without drugs or alcohol.
I had never knew about that, what is it, rules 9 and 10 about going to somebody and apologizing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it's a 12 steps, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's part of the 12-step program.
And
but please don't give away the whole
thing. I'm not giving away. But anyhow, Mike is something she can't quite figure him out because he's always with other women, and yet he's saying he loves her.
Mm-hmm.
And interesting ending. But I have to say, Jonathan left her for a terrible woman.
Yeah.
At the head of a studio almost, and she is really tough.
Yeah. Linda LaWiley Weissman.
Yes. Anyhow, I thank you, Diana. It's a book I couldn't put down, and neither will anyone else who starts it. Uh-huh. Will you autograph my
book? Oh, with pleasure. Thank you.
And we'll be back after a short pause. Thank you.